Today I'm going to cover the top 10 Excel features that you're going to want to know if you work in accounting. So not Excel functions, because for that I have a separate video. The link for it is in the description of this video. It's about features today, so let's jump in. Number one, Go to Special. With Go to Special, you get to quickly identify cells of a specific type. So for example, let's say we want to quickly see these cells that have constants and the ones that have formulas. We can go to Home, Find and Select, Go to Special. And we also get shortcuts to some of the functionalities of Go to Special. So let's say I want to highlight these cells that have constants. I can select this, and I immediately notice that only two cells are not selected. This is probably because they have formulas. If I go back to Find and Select and click on Formulas, these two are selected. If I need to, I can immediately color them in a different color. I can remove the values, change the font, and apply any type of formatting I need. Now, what else is available under Go to Special? Well, this menu here is more complete. You have more options. You can select objects, current region, or even conditional formats. So just to check whether you have some hidden conditional formatting on your sheet, it doesn't hurt to select this and click on OK. And now I can see this part of my sheet has conditional formatting applied. When I go to Manage Rules, that's the formatting behind this. With Go to Special, I get to quickly identify these. Now there is a shortcut key for Go to Special as well. It's Control G. To get to the special part, use Alt S. Number two, Automatic Subtotals. You can get Excel to automatically add subtotals for you wherever you need it without you having to write a single function. So here I have account date, transaction number, and amount. And let's say I want to add a subtotal every time account changes. Before I use that functionality though, I have to make sure that the column I want to add the subtotals to is sorted, so everything is grouped together. Let's quickly do that. I'm just going to right mouse click, sort, sort A to Z. Now that I have everything grouped together, let's go to Data, under Outline, we get to add subtotals. First question is, where do we want the subtotals to be added? We want it at each change in not date, but account. Which function should we use? Well, I want to sum the amount column, but I have other options as well. I could count, average, max, min, and so on. I'll stick to sum. Which column do I want to get the sum of? Well, the amount column. If I have existing subtotals in there, I can replace the current ones. I can also add page breaks between groups. So if I wanted to print this out on separate pages, I can place a check mark here. I'll leave summary below data and click on OK. And take a look at this. I get these rows automatically added with the correct function. On the bottom here, I get a grand total as well. All of this grouping was added by just clicking subtotal. What if you want to get rid of all these subtotals? Go back to Outline, Subtotal, and remove all. Number three, number formatting shortcuts. As accountants, you work a lot with numbers, so it helps to remember some number formatting shortcuts. For example, here, I have a list of dates, but they're shown as integer values because they have the general format. Now, I can always go here and change the formatting to a short date or a long date, but I can also use a shortcut key to do this. Let's select a range with Control Shift down and use the shortcut key Control Shift pound. In case you'd like to have a different date format, use Control 1 to bring up the Format Cells dialog box and select your formatting from here. You can also switch to date and select your date format from this list. What about other number formatting shortcuts? To change the values in the amount column to currency, select it and use the shortcut key Control Shift 4. This changes the formatting to currency. If you want it as number format, use Control Shift 1. This adds the thousand separator as well as two decimal places. Number four, formula auditing. When you work with formulas, it can get tricky to remember which cells are impacting your results. So for example, there's a function here and I quickly want to see which cells are impacting this. Now I don't want to read the formula and go back and forth, I want to visually see this. I can go to the formulas tab and click on trace precedents. I can quickly see these two cells are impacting the value in D4. To remove these arrows, click on remove arrows. Trace dependents, on the other hand, shows you which cells are dependent on the existing cell. So here in D3, I have a value that's input directly. When I click on trace dependents, it shows me that this cell, this and this, as well as this, are dependent on the value in D3. Now, what do you see if your dependent cells are on another sheet? Well, let's remove these arrows. Go to D4 and select trace dependents. This is what you see. So in this case, one cell is here, so this one is dependent on this, but this icon means there is a cell on another sheet that's dependent on this as well. To see exactly which cell that is, double click on this black arrow. You get the Go To dialog box. You'll see the list of dependent cells. In this case, I just have one, so I'm going to select that. Click on OK, and I'm going to jump to that cell that's dependent on the cell I was analyzing. Number 5, conditional formatting. The conditional formatting is a great way to quickly visualize and understand your data. You can use it to bring attention to certain cells depending on a condition. So for example, let's say for the amount column, I want to highlight the top 10%. Select this range, go to conditional formatting, top bottom rules, and select top 10%. This automatically applies a different format to these cells. Now you can adjust these settings as you need. You can change the 10 to another number. You can also change the color. So let's go with green fill with dark green text and click on OK. You can of course add more than one condition. So let's say I also want to highlight the bottom 10%, select bottom 10%, and let's leave this with light red and click on OK. All of this is dynamic. When my data changes, if this goes to 2, this one is going to get highlighted. Now, as you probably noticed, in conditional formatting, you have a lot more options than this. You can add data bars, color scales, icon sets, and you can even create your own rules. If at any point in time you want to clear the rules, you can clear them from the selected cells or clear them from the entire sheet. This is going to remove all your conditional formatting rules. Number 6, remove duplicates. Remove duplicates returns a unique list of values. Here, for example, I have transaction number and account, and I want to get a unique list for the combination of transaction number and account. Go to data. Under data tools, we have remove duplicates. Now notice my active cell is somewhere in the data set. So when I select it, it automatically picks up my data range. There's a check mark for my data has headers, which is correct. All I have to do is click on OK. 7 duplicate values were found and removed. 9 unique values remain. This is based on the combination of column A and column B. And of course, you can run this on a single column or more columns as you need. Number 7, flash fill. Unfortunately, we've received our account labels in this form where we have the code and the account description. We need to split these into 2 separate columns. We don't have to worry about formulas or using any of the tools up here. We can use flash fill, and there is an accessible shortcut key for this. All we have to do is to show it what we want, and it's going to try and figure it out for us. So in this case, for code, I want 5.1.1. So I'm basically entering what I see here. Now check this out. I'm going to highlight this range and press the shortcut key Control E for flash fill. It understands what I want, and it gives me the correct code. We can do the same for description. Let's type in cost of goods sold. Let's highlight the area. Now, in case you forget the shortcut key, Flash Fill is available on the Home tab. It's right here to the side. Under Fill Options, we have Flash Fill, and we get the description. Number 8, AutoFilter. To be able to quickly filter this dataset, use the shortcut key Ctrl-Shift-L. We immediately get these drop-down boxes where we can filter our dataset. I can select a specific field, or I can use text filters. So for example, I want to filter accounts that contain the word expenses. You can add additional filter levels. So let's say for date, I can pick a specific month. I can open this up and pick a specific date, or I can use the inbuilt date filters here. I have this week, next week, last week, so many options here. And you can also add your own custom filter. So for example, if the date is after a certain date, how do we enter it? Well, we don't have to worry about entering dates here because we have a date picker. So I'm just gonna select this date, click on OK, and I've added a second filter to this dataset. To deactivate all filters, just go back to Ctrl-Shift-L. To bring it back, press Ctrl-Shift-L again. Number 9, data validation. If you're creating templates that you want others to fill, make sure you add data validation. This is going to help you reduce the number of mistakes. So let's say I want users to fill up the account, but the account should match what we have in our central account list. I can add drop-down lists here. To do that, go to Data, under Data Tools, select Data Validation. For Allow, the default is any value, but I don't want that, I want a list instead. This will give you an in-cell dropdown. For source, well, I have it right here, so I'm gonna select this range. Now it doesn't have to be on the same sheet, it can be on another sheet. Just go to it, select it, and then click on OK, and you have your dropdown list. If you want this list on all the other rows, you can select your entire range before you go to data validation, or if you forget, like I did here, just copy your cell, then highlight this range, right mouse click, paste special, and only paste the data validation. This is going to give you the dropdown without the content. Aside from dropdown, you have many different options. So if you want to make sure that the users input the date correctly, create a date data validation. Go back to Data Tools, under Allow, select Date. You can put a start date and an end date, or you could, for example, only allow for dates that are greater than the date you specify here. You can also make this dynamic. So if you want dates after today's date, you can use the today function and then click on OK. And then the users can only input a date that's in the future and not in the past. If they try to do this, they get an error. Number 10, pivot tables. Now I left the best for last because pivot tables are really easy and super powerful. In this case, I have account, supplier, and amount. And let's say I want to take a look at total amount by supplier, or maybe I also want to take a more detailed look at supplier by account. I might want to take a look at the amount by different months. All of this is easily doable with a pivot table. With your data organized like this in columns, go to Insert, Pivot Table. Make sure your range is correct. So it's highlighting the range I want to base my report on. Then all you have to do is choose where you want to have that pivot table report placed, on a new sheet or on an existing sheet. Well, I'm going to pick existing sheet. Let's just put it on the side here and click on OK. This is going to give us a canvas for our pivot table. I just need to decide what I want to show. I want the amount, so I'm going to place a check mark beside it. It's placed it in the values column. What do I want to show in the rows? Let's go with supplier. My report automatically sums the amount. If you want to show something else, so if instead of sum, you want to show the average or the count, you can go to value field settings and change your selection from here. You can also update the number formatting. Just right mouse click, go to number format, change this to a number. I'll use a 1000 separator, 0 decimal places, and I have my values here. I can also dynamically sort this. Right mouse click, sort, sort largest to smallest. In case I want to take a closer look at account by supplier, I just need to drag account to the rows here. If I want, I can also put account in the columns to get a wider report, or I can put account in the filters up here. So I can either take a look at all accounts, I can select multiple accounts, or just select a single account. Anytime my data changes in the source, so let's change this to a 2, all I have to do is right mouse click and refresh, and my data updates automatically here. Now, what if you wanted to get more information about this number? Well, just double click on it, and Excel will create a separate sheet for you with the details of that number. Now, there is a lot more to pivot tables than I can cover here. I have a separate video on this, and I've added the link to the description of this video. Okay, so that was my list of useful Excel features for accounting. So aside from functions, what else do you think should be on this list? Comment below and let us know. As usual, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to give it a thumbs up. And if you haven't subscribed to this channel yet, consider subscribing so that we can see each other more often. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.